With an amplifier, there are many different definitions of power that are used, and there are many different definitions of gain that are used. So many definitions are required because we use different definitions at different stages of the design process. So let's look at some of these powers that are being described. There are powers at the input, such as the available input power. The available input power is the power that comes from the source. That's the maximum power that we can get from the source. But that may not be the same as the power that's input to the network, because there could be reflections from the input matching network. And also, if we move to the load, there's an available output power that comes out of the matching network, but that may not be the same as the power that's actually delivered to the load. Really, a true definition of the perhaps the most real version of gain for our final design amplifier is the power delivered to the load divided by the power that's available from the input source. But we use different definitions of gain during the design process, before we've designed the output matching network and before we've designed the input matching network. And the different definitions of gain are used at different stages of the design process. So here's a more formal definition of the different types of powers. There are three input powers, there are three output powers. So first of all, let's look at the input power. Pin is the actual power input to the amplifier. So it's the power delivered by the source to the input matching network. But that's not the same as the available power from the source. Of course, Pin is going to be less than or equal to PAI. If M1 provides conjugate matching to the active device, then the input power, Pin, will be equal to the available input power, PAI. The power that's delivered to the active device may be less than the power input to the matching network because of loss in the matching network. If M1 is lossless, the power delivered to the actual device will be the input power to the input matching network. On the output side, there's an available power at the output of the device, and then there will be power that's available to the load. Because of loss, the power available to the load could be less than the power available at the output of the active device. Finally, PL is the power that's actually delivered to the load. So there are many definitions of gain. Here are three very useful gains. So system gain, our first gain. This is the ratio of the power delivered to the load to the power that's input to the input matching network. The next gain measure is called the power gain. This is the power delivered to the load divided by the power input to the active device. And the transducer gain, our third gain, is the power that's delivered to the load divided by the available power from our source. So GT is G with an optimum input matching network. The power gain GP is G, but with the effect of M1 removed. So you can see here that these gain definitions can be used at different stages in the design. They can be used when M1 has been designed, and they can also be used, in the case of GT, it can be used when the optimum M1 has been designed. An optimum in this case is when it's designed for input conjugate matching. Some other useful gain metrics. Well, transducer gain we've already defined. This is the gain with an optimum M1. The available gain is the gain that we can obtain with optimum M1 and optimum M2. So even before we've designed the input and output matching networks, we can use the available gain. If we have optimum M1 and M2, this gain is solely determined by the active device's S parameters. Because the active device should be matched at the input, using the input matching network, and it should be matched at the output using the output matching network. Even more useful gains. So, transducer gain is a key measure of gain. This is the power that's delivered to the load given the available input power from the source. The unilateral transducer gain GTU is GT with S12 equal to 0. Ideally, the transistor would be a unilateral device and S12 would be equal to 0. So to some extent, GTU is an ideal gain. Following on from this is the maximum unilateral transducer gain, GTU max, and this is GTU with optimum M1 and M2. Of course, if we have an active device, we could use feedback to turn the device into an oscillator, and then we have infinite gain. So the restriction here with the unilateral transducer gain is that the transistor's S12 is equal to 0, or you could say that we're going to use feedback around the active device, between the output of the active device and the input of the active device, and we're going to tune that feedback network so that S12 is equal to 0. Maximum unilateral transducer gain is a very useful gain metric to use at the very beginning of the design process. Now, we can develop expressions for gain. We can take the S parameters of the active device and we can develop some of these optimum gain metrics. Now, the key mathematics that's used is that we express the gain of the device using generalized scattering parameters. Normally, the scattering parameters of the active device are provided to us using 50 ohm S parameters, but we can develop the ideal gains using the generalized scattering parameters, which involve the load resistance, the actual load resistance, and the actual source resistance. And once we've developed those gain metrics, we can refer them back to the transistor's 50 ohm S parameters. Different gains are useful at different stages of design. For example, the very first stage of design is choosing a transistor. How do we do that? Well, it turns out that GTU max, that is the maximum unilateral transducer gain, is a very useful metric in selecting a transistor. So in this case, we will look at a number of different transistors and we'll be estimating the unilateral transducer gain for each of those transistors that we're looking at, and we'll select a transistor based on that. So I'm not going to go into a lot of mathematics. You can read about that in a number of textbooks. But here are some final results. The transducer gain, here is our transducer gain here, can be expressed in terms of the S parameters of the active device. So all of the S parameters in this expression are the S parameters of the active device. In fact, they're the 50 ohm S parameters of the actual device. And here we have the reflection coefficient looking into the output matching network, and the reflection coefficient looking into the input matching network from the active device. In fact, both gamma L and gamma S are reflection coefficients looking from the active device. For a unilateral two-port, we set S12 equal to 0, and then we can come up with an expression for the unilateral transducer gain in terms of S parameters and gamma S and gamma L. Now, if we have ideal matching, the input and output matching networks will provide conjugate matching to the source and to the load respectively. And so we can write down an expression for the maximum unilateral transducer gain. And the maximum unilateral transducer gain can be expressed solely in terms of the active device's S parameters. So GTU max is a very important metric. It enables us to select a transistor. From experience, we know that it is going to be very difficult to design an amplifier to have a gain that is greater than GTU max. Of course, we can obtain infinite gain. We can turn our active device into an oscillator. So we can really achieve any gain, but experience is if we try and get a gain that's greater than GTU max, design is going to be difficult. Now, when we're doing a design, we want to trade off very many things. In the big picture, we would want to trade off efficiency, with bandwidth, with noise performance, with gain. And so if we can eliminate the number of things that affect how we do design, we're going to come up with a design that trades off the various metrics much more efficiently. So let's look at the PHEM transistor that we introduced at the beginning of this case study. So here are the maximum unilateral transducer gain of our transistor at a number of frequency. Now the frequency we want to do design is at 8 GHz. At 8 GHz, the maximum unilateral transducer gain is 13.26 dB. So what that is telling us is that it'll be very difficult for us to design a transistor at 8 GHz that has a gain of 14 or 15 or 16 dB. But if the gain we're trying to get is close to, say, 10 dB, we're going to find that the design process works fairly smoothly, we'll easily be able to achieve it. In fact, we can come fairly close to 13 dB without exotic design. So here are some more gains. These are the final gains that we'll introduce. The transducer gain, well, we've been dealing with this gain for a while. GT is PL divided by PAI. PL is the power delivered to the load. PAI is the power available from our source. So this is a fairly good measure of gain for our transistor. So GT is gain with optimum M1. The maximum available gain can be derived using the generalized scattering parameters. It takes quite a little bit of algebra, but the expression we come up with is quite simple. So GMA is the maximum available gain, and this is GT, the transducer gain, with optimum M1 and M2. We see an important metric here is this ratio of S2 over S21, and then this is modified by this expression. GMS is the maximum stable gain. It is the maximum available gain at the edge of stability when K is equal to 1. When K is greater than 1, our amplifier will be unconditionally stable. So GMS is a very good metric. When we design our amplifier, we want it to be unconditionally stable. And the reason we want it to be unconditionally stable is because it doesn't matter what happens to the input or the output. It could be that somebody puts their hand over an antenna, for example, which changes the loading conditions. We want our amplifier to be stable. We nearly always design amplifiers to be unconditionally stable. And that is because the cost of our amplifier going unstable is often too much to bear. If the amplifier in a cell phone went unstable, that would mean that our amplifier would load the output spectrum with random signals in the passband, and we'd shut down a lot of other cell phones in the area. If we are an amplifier vendor and we're selling to someone like a cell phone operator and one of our amplifiers went unstable, usually there's a fairly large penalty that must be paid. This is a penalty in dollars as well as in reputation. And so absolutely we want to avoid that.